Okay, good afternoon everybody. Selamat siang, salam sejahtera. So today we will talk about the gaming session, but maybe we are not going too much into the gaming part. But let's see and explore what are the project, apa saja project that become the building blocks of the current gaming ecosystem in Linux. So, okay, this is me. I'm a system engineer and also solution architect. I spend most of my time, I think half of my career, in academics, so doing teachings, and also I'm the system administrator of the one of Indonesia National Repository, salah satu repository open source kita yang sekarang sudah meninggal. Kambing, ya CD. And after that, I'm also building. I think I'm building two startups during my career, but now already fall off. And I go to GoTo for several years, and I'm not in Stockbit, but I'm currently looking for new opportunities. So if you guys need my skills and knowledge, so please contact me. Okay, let's start. There's several parts in here, so we are going to talk about the state of the ecosystem, bagaimana status ekosistem gaming di Linux sekarang. And also we will talk about the lower layer part, that's the building blocks that become the foundation of the Linux gaming currently. And the intersection is also the EVGAP, not much right there, but I will try to talk a little bit about the EVGAP. There's the EVGAP guy in here, he's the expert, I think. Okay, and the last part is, let's go to the device. This one, the deck. So this one is the combination, the current combination of the gaming ecosystem in Linux devices. Okay, we don't have remote.
No.
Okay, it's okay. Okay, let's start with the ecosystem first. I think you all remember, maybe several years ago, I have been gaming in GNU Linux since I think 2010. During that time, it was miserable experience. Lots of hard work we have to do with the console, or sorry, with our PC to be able to boot gaming. Lots of translation and emulation we have to do. And it's full of struggling days. I think along those years also, some native ports also come to Linux, but it still also have a glitch and lower performance. I don't know if some of you may be playing Dota 2 since the beginning of the day, maybe 2012 or 2013. I think the port was from 2014, yeah, the native of Dota. And that was a scandal horrible. Until right now, Dota is native, is not quite good also in Linux. You will get random requests and frame stuttering. And one of my friends one of my pal, and when I was working for the University of Indonesia, he always play Dota in GNU Linux. And during that time, he also a tweaker, so he always optimized his system, compiling new kernel. So in the background, compiling new kernel, but in the front end, play Dota. And when the scripter is not good enough, when it's found, you get first blood. So we call him Mr. First Blood. It's on and off, you know. No clear financial progress in GNU Linux, and I think there's a little party that interested to develop gaming or ecosystem GNU Linux until, I think, next slide. At least in the recent year, we see new console like Batukera or Retrofine. That's for distribution, and we see some console also powered by GNU Linux, but that's mostly for retro gaming. There's Sega Genesis Mini, even Atari. If you are into computer historical, there's device called Atari, and Atari now reboot this device and expand using GNU/Linux. The interesting part is Valve. When Valve came to the project, there's many contribution from Valve to the gaming ecosystem. The one project that make us happy, I think in Steam, they call Proton Project. Proton is a wrapper. It's not only wrapper, it's for from wine, but it's not only contain wine. It contain mainly most libraries that using for gaming and translation for the Windows layer to Linux, because most of the game right now is also still on Windows. We have DirectX Falcon, translation between DirectX to the 3D OpenGL Falcon, and the Falcon 3D for the DirectX 12. I think FAP has come into many ways and many things during that time. And also other consoles start to develop their own gaming distribution like ANEO. ANEO, I think the most expensive console right now, but yeah, it's come with the ANEO OS, and that's also with GNU Linux. Next slide. And now, from the ecosystem, we have this device, the Steam Deck, as the combination, and also lots of the kernel project that I will talk to in the session. And there's empowering of many potential in the gaming ecosystem. But the project, I think it's not only used for game and run, but many you need high performance system or intensive computing that can use also. We see lots of headset in the recent year, driver, the EDPF, and this many scheduled project that's coming to game. Next slide. Yes. If we see the ecosystem here, yes, there is a number of gaming that can be played on Proton. You see the site is called protondb.com.
Yeah.
So you see the increasing number of games that can be playable, you know, even that's a transition layer, but that's translated very smooth. So we can play that in GNU Linux. Except maybe for some games that contain anti-cheat, but that's another discussion that I will cover also in this talk. Okay, next. Sorry, it's too dark. Yeah, you see the gaming market is, if you see SteamDB also, the graphic is keep increasing, but you know only 2 or 3%, I think, that use Linux as their gaming device. But with incoming console like Steam Deck and also IMAO, so, this number keep increasing also. Okay, next one. Okay, this is the interesting part, the building block of the foundation that we use for the gaming. First, the project is the file system layer. You know, because there's many games that develop only in Windows, and Windows is non-cache sensitive, yeah, insensitive file system. So we have to do our file system translation to map the file location on the disk. We have doing translation in wine, but still a mess. Now there's a project on extended 4. I think there is cache insensitive project with the Unicode encoding support, so that will map directly into the kernel for the insensitive file system. And this is the project, if you see the article there. And also, next, this. The B3FS, the temporary FSID. So B3FS is not supported. If you gonna mounting SAM file system ID into SAM pad, or twice mounting in the this. With this one, it support immutable distribution. So console like this one, or maybe INEO, you will rely on the immutable distribution for the OS layer there. So nobody will kind of heavily modified or make insecure patch there, but you still can tweak it for embedded device also. So this patch is also enabled for immutable RepFS, and this also provide this capability, the B3FS. Next, few tags. If you already got your operating system pass, you also know new tags, right? How we log resources like memory and transaction in the database layer. So it's new tags. Few tags is called fast user space new tags. So we can log or reserve kernel resources on the user space layer. It's using the few tags. But few tags also still slow, because few tags only enabling you to reserve only one type of resource at one time. Now few tags too, you can reserve or lock and unlock doing some apple and many object, memory object at one time. This is really important in gaming or high performance computing, because in gaming you have to render in the back, you to draw many characters in the foreground, right? There's audio, something like that. So you have to lock many resource that you want to change also. Then this is the enablement, the few tags too. Next. Yeah, this is few tags, because few tags initially only able to do sync operation on a single resources, but this is called the few tags with sector, with E. You enable to sync operation on multiple resource. One of the wide range of games is feature. Yes. Next. And the SUD or system user, it's called user dispatcher. Like I was told before, that some games that enable entry chip, like maybe from EA, maybe some MMORPG, right? Genshin, I don't know. So the entry chip is directly doing SMB, the kernel. So you need to map the syscall and you need to transfer the layer. You cannot do it in the wild right now. But with SUD, you are doing the direct translation into the kernel, and you can remap it back to the wild. This case, yeah, game with DRM and entry chip. That's what the use case for this one. This is the call user dispatcher. Next. And MSLD or memory split lock detector handling. So sometimes game does not reserve a contiguous memory in RAM. Game sometimes reserve memory in the RAM, or some part they still reserve on the class L1 or L2 or 3K in the processor. So it's doing a non-contiguous reservation, right? Linux, in the default behavior, will trigger some security mechanism. So it will react, so what kind of this kind of behavior attacking the kernel. So with MSLD, we can do that reservation. If not, the reservation can be sold out the kernel, because the kernel think that's like a denial of service, because you're not reserving the memory in one place. This patch will enable it and mapping the necessary memory, the MSLD. Yeah. Next. Yeah. And this is the I think the killer project that summers out there, the Proton one. Because most of the game right now is translated from Windows, so we need Proton. So Proton is fork for Wine, but it's not on content only Wine. It contains so many translation layer that we need, like this DXVK, DXVK3D, GStreamer, even some bundle with Mesa open source driver for GPU, like that, and it will do the translation for you. So core system for this device, the Steam Deck, is Proton. Sorry. Yeah. Next. And also gaming kernel or high performance kernel. You know about this project? Samnode or Liquoric?
Yes.
I use.
Liquoric and Samnode are high performance kernel, especially tuned for HPC or low latency devices, because it's enabling many in-kernel scheduler optimization, and I think it's on also enable the round out of three right now. But the interesting that it use BBR2 and BBR3, I think, for decommission control. BBR is a bandwidth-based rate limiter, or if I'm not wrong. So it calculates the bandwidth from TCP connection periodically from every acknowledged HK connection. And it also measures the latency. There's many methodology on to measuring that, but BBR optimizes it with periodically compute that. So my previous research also about low condition control of TCP, I do it that with some fuzzy logic engine. In paper it's good, but Google I think do it is more simpler because it's using the arithmetic and the periodic computation of only predicting the bandwidth and latency. There's the budget for QIO scheduler, PDS, and also the enabling full text view. So this kernel also for low latency. Yes. Okay. And the next part is the EVPF on gaming. Okay. EVPF is like the old but new technology right now. It's very old. I think it's 90s technology, but popularized recently. I think between 2014 and 15. If you looking up into author or writer, then talk about EVPF is Brendan Drake, I think. Yeah. He's from Sun Microsystems and now he's in Intel. So Brendan is the writer of D-Trace and he write lots about EVPF. In the simple term, EVPF create a virtual machine in your kernel. You can create a VPF code in user space, inject it to the kernel, and it will protect it in the kernel. So if you need any data that you can tap in the kernel layer, EVPF will do that. And I think if you go to the class of this EVPF guy yesterday, you will get the point. So any type of data that you want to inject or interpret, you can do it. So any like firewalling, network protocol traversal, driver communication, you can do that with EVPF. Next. And this is the project of the gaming USB XID EVPF USB head. The head, a human interactive device, if not mistake. If you plug up your USB devices, it will send you some identifier. It's in a flat line, so there's a device identifier. What device you can do in the simple flat tree, right? And you can remap the thing after that. Especially if you have a joystick or mouse or keyboard, maybe you have those Razer branded mouse keyboard that have so many buttons, you can intercept and translate that to what you need. So it tracks the device call into layer to debug the first functionality. So if you want to map your button in the kernel layer, so what you can do it by USB HID EVPF. There's also firewall. A firewall for USB device. You want to protect the only authorized system or authorized apps that can modify the firmware on the USB device, you can use with the USB HID EVPF. And also remapping the function, the button, if you can do it by this one. There's a project here, and you can go to the article. And I think the slide will be shared by the committee, right? Yes. This one? Yes. This is also talk in the 2002 conference of the Linux Prambor. Yeah. You can go to that slide on the kernel recipes. And there's a talk about the EVPF project. I think kernel 6.3 or 6.4 already implement this one, but it's not backported in 6.1 LTS right now. But yeah, if you want to try this HID EVPF, I think FOB will be implemented later on, maybe in the next SteamOS 3.5 or 3.6. They will reuse this EVPF and porting that back from 6.3 kernel to 6.9 LTS. Yeah, okay, next. Okay, the next part, the deck. Okay. Okay, it's black. Sorry. It's not too clear in the projector. So basically the deck is it's a handheld gaming device, but also a general purpose computer device because it's a handheld PC in the form of a gaming console. So if you go to the Starbucks and you need to do your work, you will be kicked out by the Starbucks server because they think you are doing hacking there. Because you're hacking is a gaming device and they think you're still playing a game. Yeah, it's a custom AMD device, Zen 2. Current generation is Zen 3, but this is Zen 2. If you want a Zen 3 device, you have Nexus right now, the RGLI. But I don't really touch Asus right now because I've been doing a lot of mess with Zen 3 release. Some motherboard burnout and they tend to over voltage. Yeah, basically, it uses the custom Zen 2 APU and using the SteamOS. SteamOS basically only an Arch Linux. It's Arch Linux custom with the immutable root file system. And you have to use Flatpak, I think, for many updated, but you still can modify the sysctl part or systemd part to create your own services, but you have to put the binary in your home device. Yes. Okay, next. For mainly for tweaking, there's two utility on the Steam Deck. There is CryoBite. CryoBite is a sysctl tuner. Can already optimize the sysctl for your Steam Deck, and also Decoloader. Decoloader also help you to change your CPU scheduler, and lots of other helpful tool like Bluetooth controller mapping. And I think if you want to stream your game in here, the key is a plugin to if you want to become a streamer or maybe a VTuber. The key is a good tool for that. Yeah, there's a good explanation here. You can, if you already got the slide, you will have to, you can go to the YouTube part. Okay. Okay, a very interesting project. Yeah, because this is a general purpose device. People also do it, use this for many, many projects. Like this one. This one, creating an access point that can cross a lake using H02.11HE sub-bigger model. So you can create, if you going camping in the lake and your friend has the other side of the lake, you can still doing a Wi-Fi. Yeah? There's a Roomba control Steam Deck also. And the last one is interesting because you're a gamer and you want to edit more FPS and you have a very RGB. This open RGB project. So, but you have to tinkering and soldering a little bit of the deck. So you have to open the deck and adding some solder to the I2C devices, right? Okay. Next. Yeah, this is some general tip that I can give to you. Wait, is my mic is up? No. Okay. First, the CPU governor you have to set to the performance layer. It will help you to reduce the variant of the CPU frequency. You can set the governor performance. Yeah, it's we'll sacrifice a little bit about your battery performance, but you want to get a little bit frame higher, you have to stabilize the power state with the performance governor. Next. MGLRU. You have already taken your OS class. The LRU is a case management system in your kernel. The MGLRU enabling you to do generational LRU. So the kernel will select the states and time and timer, and it will check which are the least usable case when you do it is generational, like a garbage collector in the kernel. So MGLRU do that. Not a single scan periodically, but it will doing a timer and flag between those cases. So the kernel will be aware on the size and the age of the case. So it will not sacrifice too much latency with will doing garbage collector in the kernel. Yeah. Next, kernel watchdog. The watchdog is like a kernel capability that doing interrupt to your device to check your device still exists or not. But on the deck with the device is mostly there, the control mostly there. You do not need that because it will spawn your kernel. So should be disabled. Next, memlock. The memory limit only 64K. It's way prehistorical, left over from 90s or back to the 80s Unix. So you have to hit it a little bit higher, maybe like 1 gig or 2 gigs. It's okay for current RAM because 64K is like for prehistoric, for 86 maybe. Next. Okay. Many more, like kernel ticks. Mostly this is for the kernel latency where they're cycling between tasks. You have to increase it a little bit to from 300 to 1000. This is the recommended, I think, for the low latency desktop. And the default kernel is the 300 in here. You can recompile it because I think now the deck already must have a driver on the upstream. But you have to modify the limit of the capacity there. And BFT or Kyber. Kyber is the IO scaler from Facebook. It's for low latency this IO. Kernel swappiness. To maintain that your kernel not move out too many into your swap file or your swap disk, the swappiness should be reduced. You need swap maybe because some games may be not too good for memory management. I think like the recent Jedi Survivor or something like that. Memory spike quite high. Disable memory defragmentation, so compaction, so the kernel not too doing too many compaction at a time. And fatlock and fairness, this is also for the locking fairness because if the kernel detect too many lock at one time, it will start increasing the latency when doing malloc. And porticity, use BBR V2 or BBR V3 for condition control. And for socket buffer, you need to adjust the variable. I think I will show it later on, but the socket buffer at the deck. And general network buffer time. Next. Maybe before the conclusion, I will show a little bit about the this machine. So I'm checking whether my VPN is working or not. Looks like it's work. Sorry, can you see it or I need to zoom it? Yes, think you can see it right now? I think the projector is not good enough in doing. See if you see here, the deck is just yeah. It's happened all night.
sorry, forgot that. Yeah, just let me check the CPU. If you hear, it's a simple x86 CPU, as you see. It's Zen 2 based. It got the Ditec X custom APU. The clock is between 1.6 to 2.8 GHz. 512 kilobyte cache and it's standard x86. Okay. So for a little bit of the tuning, this is my current system program. Yeah. This is what I mean with the tuning up the socket number like this one. Increase to socket number, I think, to between to 32 max, and this will really impact it on how much the protocol stack can allocate the memory for accommodate your network packets. Yeah, this kind of tuning when I'm managing some router at my university, and still use this one because we got hit a lot, especially when during the national test for the entrance test. This is the backlog packet. This is to increase how many maximum number that the internal ring buffer. The ring buffer is the buffer that allocated by the Linux kernel when the network driver doing some interrupt to fetch the packets from the driver to the protocol stack. This is also maximum socket number. This is for the I think max and min maximum write and write memory from your TCP/IP stack. Also the time wait per cycle. I think this some of this setting also obsolete right now, but most of this memory setting can be used. And don't forget about this TCP congestion control BBR. Think that's it. Yeah, that's also a simple tuning, and you just put it on your startup from your device, and with the applied every startup. So the conclusion, the recent dynamic in the gaming ecosystem has spun up the interest from the developer to create some projects that benefit community or high performance PC or high performance computing and also in gaming. Valve, I think Valve is now this the most contributor of that one because it has an handheld device and Valve has the ecosystem. This Steam software, Steam shop, right now. For the Steam Deck itself, it can be tweaked because it is same. You take your general GNU Linux, it's only minimeters, and because this device is a novelty device. You can do it for many purposes. It also raised the interest in the community to do it for many. At least you are not being kicked out from Starbucks if you have to work because the server will, the waiter will not suspicious, make suspicious to you. Like you are kind of like a hacker. Okay, that's all of the day. Any question? Go ahead. But I don't bring any door prize.
That's okay.
Do I have a wisdom or just
apply
to me? In the some of the slide, it was explained that you have to, one of the trick is increasing the tick, if I remember.
Yeah.
The tick by recompiling the kernel or with the real-time kernel. As far as I know, real-time kernel it consumes more power. So does it also apply to Steam Deck?
Yeah, exactly.
if you increase the tick latency, it's kind of like increasing your power much, but I think it's this handheld device and with so much progress in the power management, it's negligible right now. But I don't know in embedded device, especially embedded device, we are limiting the power, but I think it's okay for the impact. Yes, you have to recompile if you want to apply the kernel ticks and put it or modify your Steam OS image because it's immutable. Compatibility between those two, the only manage the only thing that they change a lot is like on the immutable root file system. The other thing it can be used the same. Yeah, I think that's file still maintains this compatibility even right now. I don't find the full tree of source right now for the Steam Deck, but Steam promised us that they already upload all of this driver into the mainstream, so you can basically we can recompile the kernel and you can use any of the distribution gaming, maybe like Pop OS, Nobara, something like that. Yeah, same. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, same.
I want to ask about the back of Steam Deck. Because the Steam Deck uses SteamOS, but why Valve is unique choosing Arch as base of Steam Deck or using other stable distros like Ubuntu or Debian instead? Where is
yeah.
Use Arch and Debian?
Is that part of the war?
Is this decision?
Yeah, looks like the distro one, I mean. I don't know. I don't know, maybe developer in Valve, because I don't follow the complete history when they choose Arc between other part. But Arc is one the distro that quite, yeah, Arc Gen 2 is like. You can do a lot of modification there, of optimization. Yeah. Ubuntu and Debian or Debian based community, we have this. Kemewahan.
Luxury.
We have the luxury of people already testing, compiling these packages, so it's kind of like stable and tested. But Arc and Ubuntu based, you can like, yeah, customize for yourself a lot, targeting for your environment. Yeah. I think that's what become the one of the reason. You can use Slackware if you want to recompile everything. I was using Slackware during my old days, and you can play SD 720p on Athlon XP 2200 with smooth. But you have to recompile.
Yeah. So actually, this was. Answer my some of mystery in my life because I was following gaming Linux at gaming at Linux was since I was high school, so probably can the second bit. And the most mystery was when I tried to running War of Warship gaming online in the XT4 file system, it cannot be running at all. But when I moved to NTFS because the size is very big and it was running. Suddenly, I still don't have answer why it can be running. And you showing that.
Yeah, the cache insensitive part.
Yeah.
Yeah, because the mapping will be different between Windows and in Linux. Yeah, because if you throw all capital letters on the game asset, it will be mapping differently on Unix-based file system, right? So that's currently there's a patch for HT4 and BDFS, so it can be enabled for cache insensitive if you want to use it for gaming use case. Yeah.
actually I followed every years about gaming and stuff to Linux. And yes, I agree with you when the Dota 2 was first launched on Linux, it's very, very, very bad. Stuttering, crash, and drop FPS was often happen when in middle game. And even when I war at best, I always kill first. And after that, a few years after that, CSGO was released on the Linux 2, and same problem, many shutter, drop FPS, and sometimes was crashing. But today, I start again to gaming on Linux with my new laptop. To be honest, today was pretty good.
Yeah,
after all, the revolutionary I think come from Vulkan, because in previous was only OpenGL available,
yeah.
But now was Vulkan. So gaming in Linux today was
pretty easy,
and you can get 60 FPS with cheaper handphone.
Yeah, great. But not on Dota. Dota is still, like, I think, still crashing a lot. So I don't play Dota often because I'm noob. my friend was playing there, and yeah, he's a maniac tweaker also, so he compiled it somehow in the back end, and the front still play Dota, and when he spawned, he get first blood.
Yeah, I did not experience it.
Talk with me after this session.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.